Sips Sports Bar. We're doing our special edition of Pittsburgh Sports Line at Sips Sports Bar, right in the heart of downtown Dormont. Come on down here. It's easy to find. 3024 West Liberty Avenue. Or if you don't know, just ask somebody where Sips is. It's legendary. It's been remodeled. It has great TV screens. People are watching the TV right now. And they also have great events coming up. Matter of fact, we got a Frank Sinatra night on Saturday the 16th. Come on down from 8:30 on for Frank Sinatra. That's February 16th. On February 23rd, we have the Dave Iglar Band. Again, come out here at 8:30 at night. Enjoy the band. Now we got a whole bunch of March events coming on. The Nardozzi Brothers are on March 2nd. So make sure you come on down, see the Nardozzi Brothers. Then we have on March 9th, Gary Prisby. You know where to go, Sips Sports Bar. Saturday the 16th, the Good Guys. Same time, folks. The 23rd, the Colin McMahon Band. Make sure you check your calendars. And then the best one for Smoking Jim and I, and even Chipper, he can bring Stephanie, the daddy-o of the radio. Porky Chedwick is here, March 30th. So make sure you're there. That's a couple of my promotions here for Sips Sports Bar. Oh, wait a second. They have food specials here. Two house specials. Get your Sips Build-A-Burger. You can get a half-pound burger and put whatever you want on there. The only thing that costs extra is the blue cheese. So pile that burger up there, folks. Then we have a Sips Legendary Fabulous Giant Fish Sandwich. It's just one of the biggest around, and it's the most popular fish sandwich in the neighborhood here, guys. Check it out. That's my Sips promos. We'll get into other promos later on. But for all of you that know the show and the ones that don't know the show, we talk about what's on our mind. Chip, what's on your mind?
Thanks, Alan. And good evening, everybody, and welcome to Sips Sports Lounge. I said that without stumbling over it. I'm getting really excited right now. Baseball season's starting. Training camps are opening up, and we're going to get more into baseball as we go on with the show. We have a guest, quite knowledgeable baseball man, and we'll be picking his brain a little bit. But what's on my mind is college basketball. If you've been paying any attention to college basketball in the last week, I think every team that's been rated number one hasn't been rated number one for more than a day. Right now, I think there's more... What do they call that? The mediocrity, I guess, in basketball.
Parity
in basketball.
Positive. There's parity.
Any one of these teams can win the tournament. But I've really been impressed by the Pitt Panthers lately. The Pitt Panthers basketball team did something yesterday that the Pitt football team hasn't done in 3 years. They came from behind and won.
Pitt's known for that, buddy.
Pitt last week had finally broken into the top 25. They made a little visit at number 25, and then they lost a couple of games. But last week, they broke in at number 23, and they won a couple of big games this past week. And they got bumped all the way up to number 16. And I'm telling you what, Pitt's playing defense right now. Pretty lights out. They probably got one of the best defensive basketball teams in the NCAA, and look for them to do something. It looks like this team is coming together come tournament time. It's going to be an insane March for college basketball. They talk about March Madness. Well, there's going to be some serious March Madness this year, and I'm really looking forward to it. But that's what's on my mind.
Thanks, Chip. I appreciate what's on your mind, and that helps me since I made that prediction. NCAA tournament for Pitt. So you're helping pump my ego up here a little bit here, Chip, so thanks. Now, Smoking Jim Frazier, what's on your mind?
Hey, thanks, Ella, being the talking machine. And I tell you what, it's great to be here and watching Delaware Hens on TV. That's my favorite college team. My two favorite players from the Delaware Hens football team is Joe Flacco and Gino Gradkowski, seating the sales zone. And I tell you what, my two favorite football teams in college is Delaware and New Hampshire, to believe it or not.
I don't believe it.
But if they have fantasy fantasy football for drop passes, Mike Wallace would be in the Hall of Fame. Why is he still on the team? Mike, the Pittsburgh Steelers need to drop Mike Wallace like he drops all those passes. Before the season started, Mike Wallace turned down $50 million. The Pittsburgh Steelers need to take that $50 million they offered Mike Wallace and give it to Heath Miller, because it's Miller time. Heath Miller has more touchdown catches than any other tight end in Pittsburgh Steeler history. He's third all-time leading receiver in Pittsburgh Steeler history, behind only Hines Ward and John Stallworth. He has more catches than Lynn Swan, Lewis Lips, Eric Green, and Mark Bruner. Pittsburgh Steelers do the right thing when it comes to Heath Miller and pay the man.
Thanks, Smoking Jim. I don't know why I decided to follow you anymore, but there's no way I can compete with that. Lung power and facts, there's no doubt. So thank you. What's on my mind? We have a couple things on my mind. First of all, you have Penn State. My prediction is the biggest scandal in U.S. history. Now you have people countering the free report, but they didn't counter the free report. They only tried to make Joe Paterno look like a better person. I think it made him look worse, because now you stirred up all these people who are polarized against him and for the free report and all this stuff. They forgot about the victims. That's the ones that we should pray for. The guy in the is in jail, Sandusky, that's a good thing. But there's other people that should be in jail also. That's not really what's on my mind, folks, but it's a topic here, and it gets me upset because Free's actually a criminal. Just study the history of Louis Free. Check out his FBI stats and everything else, then come back to the show. Come and visit us here at Sip Sports Bar. We can get in a little debate about the honesty of Louis Free. Penguins. That's the sports thing that's on my mind. All of a sudden, 6-game winning streak. Oops, now it's a 2-game losing streak. I thought it would be a good thing if you play the Devils. You get beat by them, now you come to get that home cooking. 2-3 at home. What's going on with the Penguins here? They act like they're a road team, and the crowds. I can't believe when you hear a game in Pittsburgh that I don't hear the fans. Maybe I hear a little rumbling and I see a wave up in the upper deck, but what's going on with the fans? That's what's on my mind.
Well, you know what, Alan? You know, just to kind of touch on a couple of points that you brought up, in your opening talk, you know, this whole thing with Joe Paterno's widow coming out and defending, Joe Paterno's honor, and I understand what she's doing and why she's doing it, and really, you know, the facts are the facts of this situation. There's nothing about the whole situation that's good. It was a horrible situation for everybody involved, most importantly to the children that were abused. But, you know, nobody's going to change anybody's opinion about Joe Paterno or how that was all, how everything came down, because, you know what, it's all done. People have made their decisions. You know, we can't keep on ripping the scab off this wound.
Right.
You know, and what we really need to do is, you know, just put it all behind us, you know, and sooner or later people will think more fondly of Joe Paterno. But trying to say that, you know, he walked on water, maybe he's not going to get canonized for sainthood. But also, you know, you're talking about the Penguins, the biggest crowd participation I saw yesterday was when Bertuzzi got in that fight 4 seconds into the game. But, you know, you think the Penguins have 259 or 260-some sellouts in a row.
Right.
You think the Penguins fans are just, you know, become a little bit complacent, with the product that they see on there. They see this team.
Well, I got another theory. We'll talk some Penguins later on, and we'll touch on this some more, because I want to bring up the theory that, I believe is happening there. And
go ahead.
We'll get into the dollars and cents on that one. Now, Michelle's been a guest on our show before, and she does she's an entrepreneur. And she does all kind of great things with fundraising and in the community here. And she's just expanding her business with helping a lot of young artists and other people in the area. So, Michelle Barabas, what can you tell us about your business tonight?
Well, my company is the Art Resource Teaching Society, and we represent artists from across the United States. We connect them with work, and we also help charity organizations as well as schools and other nonprofits fundraise. So we're currently hosting auctions online to help all different types of organizations. We have a youth art program that is going to be completely free, and it's intended to replace the disappearing art and music classes in our underfunded local schools.
Could you get into something about these auctions? What are you auctioning off, and how does that work? Because that's interesting with the way people have different art to sell, and it's a nice concept to get it out there and what they do.
Absolutely. We're really all for having the artists make a career of what they're doing, so it's not sustainable for them to continue donating items for all different auctions and fundraisers and whatnot. So what we do is we have the starting bid be the artist's price, and everything beyond that goes directly to the charity organization, so that way artists are paid full price for their services. We auction off things like guitar lessons and photography sessions where you can have photo shoots done for your senior pictures or couples photo shoots or really anything. We represent artists of all different media, so each auction includes about 60 items, and the fundraising potential is phenomenal as long as you have an online donor community.
How do you connect up with one of these auctions so that you can
to get in touch with me?
Right.
The only thing you have to do is send an email to artsincorporated@gmail.com. That's artsincorporated@gmail.com, and get on the list.
There you go. And the other question I have is, so people can get an idea of what are the price ranges, like what would be a low bid that you would start at?
Well, the starting bid being the artist price can be anything based upon what your audience is. So we really find out exactly what your people usually buy, the people that are involved in your communities, whether it be parents or donor communities online, whatever they're interested in. We base the starting bids on the services that they want. So we have items as low as $25 as a starting bid, and items as high as $3,000, $10,000 as a starting bid. It really depends on the organization.
Oh, that's good. And the other thing is, for some reason, since we moved to downtown Dormont, Michelle is also a resident of downtown Dormont. She just lives a few doors away.
Yeah,
so this was actually convenient here for her to stop by. And I wanted to thank you online, or on the show here, for introducing us to Tempe Moore.
Oh, she was on last show.
She was on the last show.
Her work is amazing.
That's the reason that she was here. Michelle actually is a great connector. We know a lot of people in the community here, and we've actually met at Entrepreneurial Thursday with Jessica Lee, who does her jazz networking show. And I just wanted to inform you about that. I'm also producing a show that we're taking film from her Thursday nights. So now you can see on BPTV, Jessica Lee performing her songs with her jazz networking. We're filming it each Thursday night. So if you can't watch it on TV, come down to Little E's on Liberty Avenue at 5:30 to 8 every Thursday, and you'll see Jessica Lee, Entrepreneurial Thursdays with Jazz Networking.
They're a ton of fun.
It's not only fun, it only costs you $5. And that's all it costs to come in there, and you meet people like Michelle and others that do these type of things. And thanks again for coming on the show.
Thank
I appreciate
you,
it. And good luck to you.
Thank you very much, Michelle.
Can't wait to get down to Little E's.
You got to come Little E's on Thursday night, I'm telling you guys. You don't even have to drink smoking, Jim. $5 gets you in the door. Here's what I drink there. No problem. Music's great. We have another guest who I just met recently, and we've become great friends, and he happened to tell me that he's a sports guy. And he goes, don't ask me about all the sports, but if you want to talk baseball and fantasy baseball, can you get me on the show? This was 2 weeks ago. I called him up the other day. This is John Galeza. Welcome to the show, John.
Good evening,
John. Thanks for coming in.
Thanks for coming. I spent quite a bit of time picking John's brain before
we got
on the show here. So.
Well, we're not going to dominate the rest of the show. But
45 minutes or something?
You have maybe about 10 minutes right now, 15, depending on how you are. Because with your gear you're wearing, I noticed you have a favorite team Padres?
No, it just said matches, and it was clean.
There you go.
Pirates are my team.
Okay, well, that I'm just trying to clarify that.
That's right. Might be 48.
I'm representing the colors right here.
Okay, fair enough, and I appreciate you wearing a hat tonight, so that's a good thing. We won't get into that till later on, maybe.
The glare would be a killer.
Okay, you said it. So. Where do you want to start with this baseball?
Well, I'll tell you what, I'm just... this without a doubt. I was talking to Chip a little bit before, just met him actually, but
you're now best of friends and Pirate fans.
Oh, you, you give me something to talk baseball and can get deep into baseball, man. I'll talk all night. But the thing I really want to talk about is the Pirates are in first place, right?
Hey, they haven't lost a game. We're undefeated.
Every other team's in first place, too.
We're undefeated.
But you know what? If you really look at the Pirates, and what I want to talk about is their pitching staff. I mean,
well, we'll get into a whole bunch of things because I know what you want to talk about, but I'm a disgruntled Pirate fan. I know, but I'm not happy with the ownership. But I am happy with some of the progress they've made. When I look at the bottom line, I'm happy there. But since we're starting with pitchers and catchers, I think that ties in with what you want to talk about. So where would you like to start on the pitching?
Well, you know, if you look at their staff, and I got to take notes because this is my, I'm still nervous, first time on TV and everything.
But, okay, we'll try to keep you calm here.
You look, you got A.J. Burnett, J-Mac, who I still think is a really solid number two starter. Mm-hmm. You've got Wandy Rodriguez, Francisco Liriano, who fell down in the bathtub, but he saved us a lot of money in doing so. And then, you know, if you look at the rest of all the guys that they have coming into spring training, Chip, we were talking about this, you got Jeff Karstens, Kyle McPherson in AAA, Jeff Locke, Andrew Oliver is a name to watch. Andrew Oliver is a kid that they got from Detroit. Mm-hmm. He was a former first-round draft pick. Lefty, throws hard, but control has always been
his. How old of a kid is he?
25, 26 years old. So if he can somehow find that.
Well, how's his arm? Has he had Tommy John surgery? Because we're notorious for getting these players, and they need Tommy John surgery.
To speak to that point, that's a problem that's all across baseball.
Right.
Okay, because pitchers, you know, they flaws in their mechanics cause these things to happen. But the Pirates brought, I think they're bringing 31 pitchers into spring training this year. 31 pitchers. Yep. They're going to find somebody that can do the job, okay? I mean, you bring in that many arms, you know, you're going to be evaluating everybody's talent. And I'll tell you what, the roster spots aren't, there's no givens. There's one or two. Right. I was talking to John earlier, and I was saying that I think Wandry Rodriguez and A.J. Burnett, okay, that's two-fifths of your starting staff. And I think pretty much every other position in the starting staff potentially is up for grabs. Now, I know J-Mac, everybody's looking at him as being a regular starter, and if he can pitch the way he pitched the first half of last year, I mean, he's going to be a great addition. Karstens is a serviceable enough starter, but his issue has he been able to stay healthy long enough?
Right.
You know, so we got him at
a
bargain price instead of overpaying for him. But, you know, some of these young arms, I'm interested to see how they pan out.
All right, so you got us going here. You might be on here a little longer than 10 minutes here, John.
Okay, I got plenty of notes.
You sure?
Could you
hang with us a half hour on baseball? Because Smoke and Jim and I are going to have to pepper you with some questions, too.
Yeah, just don't
a little
ask
pepper
me about
in
basketball.
The beginning of the season. We're going to get basketball. We're going to get boxing. Don't you worry. We got some of those subjects to bring up. So, but go ahead with your pitching here.
Well, Andrew Oliver's a kid I like. Garrett Cole, obviously, their number one prospect.
Will he make it up here?
I think he's going to be a typical Pirates. We're going to wait till that magical day where we can keep him another year and not pay him. So look for him mid-July. But if he keeps progressing the way he's been going, hard thrower, 95 to 98 miles per hour, good secondary stuff, live arm, and he can pretty much blow away anybody in anybody's lineup. Mm-hmm. Jonathan Sanchez, I don't know if you, he's a name that sort of goes under the radar. Lefty from a couple years ago with the San Francisco Giants, struck out over 200 guys 2 years ago. But since then, he has just, you know, one of those guys that just all of a sudden fell off the face of the earth and totally lost everything. If he can find it.
Well, you know, and you know where you find sometimes with these pitchers, they say, you know, the pitching coach and the prospect may not just may not click. Ray Searidge has done a real good job at managing the Pirates staff, because, you know, as badly as the Pirates did last year, without the pitching that they had through most of the season, they wouldn't have even been 16 games over 500, because, you know, memory doesn't fail any of us. Pirates bats were ice cold first 2 months of the season last year. And it was our pitching that even got us to the point where we were 500. So, I mean, he is doing an amazing job at managing the staff.
And we have a new hitting coach, Jay Bell. So,
you know what? I forgot all about that.
Right. Well, that's why I'm here, to bring up some trivia with
baseball.
Well,
and Jay Bell came to the Pirates from the Diamondbacks. And he'd been doing a very good job with managing the hitters and the Diamondbacks. And it's a far cry better than the gentleman that was doing the job last year.
Right.
I mean, your job as a hitting coach is to help, you know, correct flaws in people's swings.
Sure.
And if you're sitting there doing nothing but watching videotape, you're not working with the people, helping to correct it. I mean, the same guys that were making the same mistakes in April and May were making those mistakes in August and September. And, you know, you need to see some level of improvement or something. And that was the reason why that change needed to be made.
Definitely.
You're right.
You still have 25 more pitchers to get through.
I got more where that came from.
Hey, we're not going to go through all of them. Pick some of these good guys. Pick a guy or two that we'll see.
Chip and I talked about who I got big hopes for coming back off Tommy John surgery, Charlie Moore.
Yes.
Guy who 2 years ago, you know, who was the last manager? John Russell.
John Russell.
Drove him into the ground, and all of a sudden he found himself and pitched really well last year. He got hung up with Tommy John surgery, but I'm looking for him to come back mid-July and get back into the rotation.
Yeah, and you know what? I think, you know, I mean, in these athletes, you know, and anybody that's played sports, you know, you want to play. And you get dinged up your heart, and I think Charlie Morton did more to hurt himself last year by trying to pitch through pain instead of just shutting it down earlier in the year and saying, you know what, something isn't right. But, you know, I mean, I'm really looking forward to him coming back, because, you know, all the baseball scouts that I've read say that he's got stuff like Roy Halladay. And if you can put a pitcher like that on a mound every 4 or 5 days, you know, that's going to help you. I mean, he's a sinker ball pitcher. People are going to beat the ball into the ground all day long on him. And, you know, right now the Pirates infield is as good as it needs to be able to handle that kind of a pitcher.
All right, we'll wrap up the pitchers here. Do you got another couple pitchers that are close to getting up here or not?
I'll tell you the guy who's, well...
Who's your top guy you think could make it?
Here's the guy that nobody has heard about, I think.
That's why we brought you on.
The guy that was acquired...
You're a secret weapon here, John.
I like... Definitely. You're talking me up way too much, but I'll take it.
All right.
Clint Robinson. They got in the offseason. It's a trade you heard nothing about from Kansas City. 6'5", 240-pound first baseman, 26 years old, from the Kansas City Royals. And the reason, why did we get him? Well, in Kansas City, he's stuck behind Billy Butler and Eric Hosmer.
Yep.
Guy that's 6'5", 240, can do nothing but first base or DH.
Right.
So he had absolutely nowhere to go. Awesome numbers. The awards he had in the minors every year, all-star, postseason all-star, midseason all-star. But he's stuck there with nowhere to go in KC. He's the kind of guy that could make Garrett Jones expendable and bring in something else that we may need, maybe more pitching. I'm a big believer, and that's why I'm excited about all the pitching they brought in.
31 pitchers.
You get enough pitching, you can acquire anything you want in a trade. I don't know how you feel,
no,
Chip.
You know, absolutely. I mean, a baseball team's got to have a deep, deep pitching staff, because last year's a perfect example. You saw people starting to get hurt, and, you know, things start to fall apart. And that's a very good point about, you know, somebody that could possibly make Garrett Jones expendable. I mean, I love Garrett Jones. He's a great guy from the city of Pittsburgh. He's a great guy in the clubhouse and everything. You know, last year, I mean, the guy's 31 now, okay? He's no longer a young and upcoming prospect. He's an established major leaguer. And last year, he had a career year. You know, I hope that isn't the best year he has. I hope that's you know, more along the lines of what we could expect. But, you know, Garrett Jones is going to be somebody that's not going to have a long-term future with this team. So, you know, you have to look towards okay, who am I going to get to replace him? Because if it's not this year, then, you know, going into next. Because next year, he goes to arbitration again, you know, he may price himself out of Pittsburgh.
Other good points. Go ahead.
I'm interested in getting your opinion, Chip, on, you know, I've heard both sides of it as far as trading Joel Hanrahan. What are your thoughts on the Joel Hanrahan trade?
I had a caller last year call up and asked me. One of my friends, and he took me to task and tell about how the Pirates should get rid of Joel Hanrahan. And during the season, while the Pirates were still up, you know, and ultimately, you know, about 16 games over 500, I thought it would have been a really bad move at that point because I felt that that Joel Hanrahan was an integral part of the reason why they were there. Now, moving forward, you know, Joel Hanrahan is somebody that, you know, he was getting to the point where, how much more are we going to get out of him? And right now, his value was as high as it could be. And, you know, ultimately, if we were going to lose him, because we were only going to have him one more year, because after arbitration this year, he could have gone and become a free agent. You know, the best move we could have made would have been to trade him to get everything that we could. And apparently, there is some talent that that may make the Major League roster this year that we got for him. So I'm thinking, you know, as much as I hate to see Joel Hanrahan go, I think they could find somebody to handle the closer's job. I'm not exactly sold on the idea of Jason Grilly, even though I love him as a setup man. I don't know if he's the closer, but, you know, there's one of these young arms might come in. And, you know, if they're only asking somebody to pitch one inning a game, get somebody out there to throw 100 miles an hour, you know, I mean, you don't really need to worry about, you know, the longevity of him and, you know, see what happens. But I think he became expendable as far as Joel Hanrahan.
I would agree. I know one of the guys that they got from Boston, Mark Melancon, he closed for Houston a couple years ago, and he can be a serviceable closer as well. And, you know, some people always worry about, oh, my gosh, how could you trade Hanrahan? Well, I'll give you a couple names. Remember Evan Meek?
Yep.
Yes. Evan Meek, 2-3 years ago, everybody's like, oh, you can't trade Evan Meek, you can't trade Evan Meek. They didn't trade Evan Meek. You know where he's at now? He's on a minor league deal with the Texas Rangers because he fell off the face of the earth. The shelf life of a closer, in my opinion, is very, very small. John Axford, 2 years ago, lights out, couldn't touch him. Last year, John Axford for the Brewers was a train wreck.
Yep.
He was on my fantasy team. I know he was a train wreck. So, you know, when these closers, you got to...
Is that a money thing? Fantasy league?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Well, then understand your pain there.
And, you know, and then one of the things with the way the Pirates are building their team, and they've had a couple articles in the local paper on Sunday and today talking about how the Pirates are building their team, and they're building the team for this market. And they're building it through the prospects and getting all these people that are no names that are going to get, you know, instead of spending money on proven commodities that, you know, that ultimately people end up overpaying for. It's kind of nice to watch somebody like the Yankees having to eat a contract like Alex Rodriguez.
Right.
You know, I mean, because, you know, they're finally getting, they're paying the piper finally. You know, you can't do that for forever. But for a city like ours, that won't put fannies in the seat. The way they're building this team, you know, we had $2 million last year. I expect the same thing this year.
Well, I hope that they can get above 500 because we're going to make our bet again. You know, I always bet a dollar, at least the last 12 years. I've been victorious that they won't go above 500. I actually was wavering. The dollar come up.
And I'll sweeten the bet this year. I'll sweeten the bet this year because I'm not saying 500. I'm saying they make the playoffs this year.
No. I'll keep my same bet. The dollar bet. We'll get to that later.
Imagine if you'd have made it 100.
Then people aren't going to bet me. Right? You're going to throw a dollar out there to tease him. Here's our professional gambler out here. He'll tell you about odds and things. Maybe not in the baseball world, but we'll go there. Who do you think with catchers? I always think our catching's weak because you need two guys to do what one catcher on the other teams do. So who do we have that's going to be a catcher that I can root for to hope we get to 500?
Well, we were talking about catchers before the show, and Russell Martin's the big name that they signed from the Yankees. And if you think about it, you know, Russell Martin signed that contract like that, and why? Because they overpaid him a little bit, and he said, you know what, 2 years, $17 million, I'm going to hop on that while I can, because I think he only hit about 220, 230
last year. He got above the Mendoza line, so that's a bonus.
He didn't have his best year offensively last year, but, you know, the thing about Russell Martin that made him so desirable to the Pirates is that he's a starter that you can start now. It's going to do better at keeping runners closer to first base. And he handles the pitching staff very, very well. The Yankees are going to miss him behind the plate this year. And that's really, Barajas, you know, had a connection with A.J. Burnett. But, I mean, he couldn't throw out my grandmother.
And he couldn't hit. he couldn't hit either. I think he ended up above 200, but he couldn't hit. They say he's a great guy in the clubhouse. Well, we can have all the great guys in the clubhouse, but we still need some W's here.
I'd be a great guy in the clubhouse. Yeah, pay me the league minimum. I'll be a great guy in the clubhouse.
I think we all would. So, but you think, what about some younger catchers? Anybody else that maybe up and coming here?
Well, you know, they have one guy, and his name escapes me, who they just drafted last year, was the number one catcher in the draft, Matthias or something along those lines. Yeah. Now, Tony Sanchez was the first round draft pick of Huntington 3-4 years ago. Mm-hmm. Now, Tony Sanchez is at that point where he needs to either pick it up or he's going to be getting left in the dust pretty
another
soon.
Another Sanchez.
Yep. Yeah, they got Gabby Sanchez.
They're
Tony
not related,
Sanchez,
though.
Jonathan Sanchez.
Yep. It's like Smith smoking, Jim. It's like Smith.
Yes.
That's how that is.
That's your Hispanic Smith.
But we're hoping the Fort, too. Hopefully the Fort can do what he did last year.
The Fort. You know, he excites us, and he seems like he's a nice guy, and he can hit once in a while, and he does throw one or two players out, so he calls a good game.
Absolutely.
No doubt. Well, I'm going to break away. We're going to keep you here because we're going to get more in-depth with the Pirates in a little bit, but I can't keep smoking Jim Frazier on the bench any longer. We got to talk. We got to talk a little bit of boxing, because this gets into the time of year with all the boxing, and I want to hear some highlights about what happens now with boxing, my friend.
Well, thanks, Al Levine, the talking machine. I tell you what, I was enjoying all this baseball talk. I tell you what, I'm already a fan of what Clint Robinson. I can't wait to see that guy, man. 6'5".
He sounds like a tight end. You're an NFL scout. You'll get him a job with the Steelers if Heath doesn't come back right away.
But this is the golden time of the season for boxing, pro and amateur boxing. You know, we just had Lightning Rod Soko on. He just won a title. We got a lot of young professional fighters here locally. We just had Pittsburgh hosted a Canadian national team, fought some of our top amateur boxers this past weekend, and now we're stepping up.
Excuse me, was Jimmy Civetic in charge of that?
Jimmy Civetic.
Because I saw him at the Soka fight. He was handing out literature, flyers, and everything else. Did you talk to him that night, or were you there?
Well, I wasn't able to make it.
Okay.
But I was there in spirit.
Okay.
But the Golden Gloves is where we really flourished. The Golden Gloves is an opportunity for a tournament for local boxers here to step their game up and fight the best fighters in Philadelphia. And we all know that boxing is big in Philadelphia. When we got started on this journey about 7 years ago, we were lucky to get one victory against Philadelphia. Now it's about 50-50, and the guys that usually take a state title, like Fast Freddie Latham last year, usually turn professional right after that, because if you can beat the best guys in Philadelphia, you can pretty much hold your own on the professional ring.
And don't forget, Freddie was on the show. He's fighting in Indianapolis on Saturday night, the 16th.
Yes, he is.
So we'll have him back after he knocks a kid out in a couple minutes.
Well, Freddie's problem, he got the same problem Iron Mike Tyson had, and Freddie's going back to Indiana where Mike Tyson had his problem. So, Freddie, stay away from the girls in Indiana, brother.
Just bring your parents. My advice is bring your mom and pop there, and they'll take care of you. They called me up, and
he better bring Daz Bryant security. That's the only thing going to keep Freddie away from the women.
Well, Smoking Jim, when are you going to be announcing any of these Golden Glove fights? That's what I want to hear. I want to try to show up there.
Well, you know, the exciting thing is you read that all the great things that's happening here in March at Sips Bar,
right.
Sports Bar, and there's five Saturdays in March, and all five of those Saturdays will be hosting Golden Glove tournament bouts.
Really? Where are you going to be doing those fights at?
All over the place, and all over southwestern Pennsylvania, because the best in southwestern Pennsylvania fights the best in the east, which comes out of Philadelphia. Some guys every once in a while emerge out of Harrisburg, but most of the team comes from Philadelphia.
And for all of you guys and girls watching this on YouTube or on Verizon throughout the area or at Bethel Park on Comcast 7, now we're on Verizon 32. So you can see Sips Sports Bar, Pittsburgh Sports Line at Sips Sports Bar on Verizon 32. Kelly, who was on the show last week, when I called her up to see if she could see it, saw it in Beachview.
Wow.
So we've had people in Monroeville, South Fayette, Mount Lebanon, Upper St. Clair. Come on down to Sips Sports Bar on Monday nights. You can even get on board, maybe like John Galeza here, and maybe you're an expert and one of the sports that we don't know about. Or maybe we'll just talk about one of the sports with you here. So you're definitely welcome. Check us out on YouTube. That's our boxing segment. If you want to find out more information, we do a live show on Tuesday nights, Pittsburgh Sports Line in the studio. We'll have more information. Maybe we'll have some flyers from Smoke and Jim in the next couple weeks on where these boxing matches will be held. And now another thing that comes to my mind is the Steelers. You got all these guys that are restricted free agents, some that are just going to be gone from the club. And Chip and Smoke and Jim, they talk in depth about a lot of this stuff. So I'm just going to turn the table to Smoke and Jim Frazier and Chip on what their thoughts are with some of these free agents and the restricted free agents. Should we keep them? Should we get rid of a couple of these guys like Mendenhall, Wallace, etc.?
That's the question that needs to be answered, because, I mean, there's some stalwarts in our defense that, you know, we're so used to seeing there. People like Troy Polamalu and James Harrison, who may become cap casualties, unless they're willing to renegotiate. These are guys that, are getting paid a lot of money and have spent a lot of time hurt and not getting the production out of them that earned them those paychecks.
They have a cap problem. The Steelers have the annual cap problem, and somehow they massage that each year. Smoke and Jim can get into some of that on how they do it, Chip, because you see that stuff.
That's what they're going to try to do, because, these contracts these guys sign, they're backloaded. So the last 2 years of the contract is when they're getting all their money, and that's how they get around the cap, is they give them extensions, they give them a minimum salary, X number of bonus, it's prorated over 5 or 6 years. But, sooner or later, you can't rob Peter to pay Paul.
So who are we getting rid of?
Well, in my opinion, I would keep almost everybody. Steelers were hurt last year. They still got a lot of players that Bill Cowher brought in. So the nucleus of Bill Cowher's team and coaching staff is still here. I would keep everybody here. I like the running backs. Everybody says the Steelers ought to go after Alabama's running back, Eddie Lacy. I don't know if you want to go after a guy whose nickname is Left Hook Lacy a few months after Chris Rainey smacked his girlfriend. So what I would do in the first round, I would go to Central Michigan and get Eric Fisher. Eric Fisher is a 6'8", 325-pound left tackle that's going to be outstanding. He's the best left tackle I've seen to come through the college ranks since Jonathan Ogden. So and Tony Baselli.
Do you honestly think that he'll be around come the 17th pick? Isn't that where we were drafting at number 17? I mean, I've done some reading up about him, and he's like the highest rated offensive lineman on everybody's board. So, I'm thinking that he's probably going to be a top five or top six pick in the draft.
Well, the one good thing is that's what everybody said about Rod Woodson. That's what everybody said about Troy Polamalu in 2003, but the Steelers was able to move up. They have some ammunition on that team. They got some fat on that team where they can trade up, move up, do what you can do to get that left tackle. I tell you what, before I started talking about Eric Fisher, nobody was talking about Eric Fisher. Now he's the buzzword everywhere. This guy's tremendous because most guys, 6'8", is not strong enough in a run blocking game. This guy is a freaking nature exception to the rule. I would do everything I can to get him.
It would make perfect sense. I mean, problems with the Steelers' offensive line. The list is as long as my arm. And at some point, Ben's going to become less and less mobile as he gets a little longer in the tooth, and they're going to have to get somebody to protect him. You know, the fact that he was a young man and able to escape, when he was younger, but he's getting older, he's getting hit more often, he's getting hurt.
But if the Steelers can't get Killer Fisher, I tell you what, I can live with 6'2", 255-pound, runner-up in the Heisman voting, Manti Te'o. I tell you what, the next junior Seau, no doubt about it.
Well, I don't think he's dropping in the draft. that imaginary girlfriend and all the rumors about him, they just care what he does on the field.
He got good taste.
Yeah, he does. Some of the best.
He dreams up a good one.
Well, tell him what they dream.
Just to get a little laugh on Manti Te'o, there's a minor league baseball team that's going to have a Manti Te'o's girlfriend bobblehead night. You know what they're going to do? For the first 1,000 people that come in the stadium, they're going to get an empty box.
I like that. That's cool, that man.
It's true. I don't know what the name of the minor league team is that's doing that. But
well, I can't wait till he gets drafted. Then he has to put up with that for maybe about 6 months or so, and then he proves himself that he can make a tackle. Not like in the championship game where he couldn't tackle anybody. I guess he was so distracted because he couldn't hit that girlfriend like the rest of those players. But hopefully he'll get past that. And if he does become a Steeler, I'd like to see it. But I question you, Smoking Jim. You're saying keep all these players. You predicted 8-8. What are you doing? Predicting 8-8 again. So you're trying to make your own prediction come true.
You know what? If you look at the Steelers' 2013 schedule, it's a super easy schedule. I tell you what, Roger Goodell gave the Steelers the 2013 schedule on the platter. They can go 12-4 if they stay healthy. If they stay healthy next year and bring back the nucleus, then you still got to get some offensive linemen from somewhere. That offensive line is in disarray. But other than that, the Steelers have enough players that Bill Cowher put this team together that's structured for the long run. And I tell you what, they got one more year with this group. And with the easy schedule that they have, I would bring everybody back and make one last run at it.
You know, last year before the season, Jim and I both agreed, we both called the Steelers, we're going to be 8-8, and everyone else was saying 11 wins, 10 wins. But the difference between the 8-8 Steelers of last year and what could have easily been another 12-4 team were just, a small handful of plays. I mean, the Steelers, even though they were 8-8 last year, in a lot of those games they lost, they could have very easily won, okay? And plays were made on the other side of the ball, not theirs. They still have the nucleus. I'm just wondering, Pete Kugler, who's now down in Western Texas at his old alma mater, what kind of a difference is having a new philosophy and an offensive line coach going to have on this team this year? Because, I mean, it seemed like every year that Kugler was here, everyone said how great of an offensive line coach, and all we did was complain about how poorly the offensive line played. I'm waiting to see what kind of a difference a new coach is going to make.
Well, the Steelers haven't had a good offensive line coach since Russ Grimm left. That was the big problem. Russ Grimm was a tremendous offensive line coach, a Hall of Famer, a legend, a Hall, and that's the type of offensive line coach that you need to get in here.
Well, I'm a drinker of Steeler Kool-Aid, and we could keep going on and on, especially your teasing me, Chip, with how close we were in most of the games. But I'm going to move on to the Penguins here, because they're 8-5. We'd actually be thankful if we weren't predicting they'd be in the Stanley Cup. I mean, 8-5 is not bad with a shortened season. They didn't have training camp. A lot of the players weren't in shape. And, we're going to discuss some of the Penguins. We touched on some of it earlier.
Yeah, so. And, we were talking before about how, disinterested in the game the Penguins fans are because they're so used to seeing, some of the most talented players around. But, I think, the five-game winning streak was great. It was like, okay, the Penguins started off the year, it was like, okay, which team is going to show up? And then they showed what they're capable of doing. And I think, you know, what Pittsburgh sports teams need is they need a little slice of humble pie every now and then to remind them that they're not as good as the press clippings. And, you know, losing two games to New Jersey home and home is a reminder of how much work they have yet to do, because they're not going to run all over the league this year. Sure, we've got one of the most talented teams in the league. The thing that I find confusing is I see Evgeny Malkin skating all over the ice with the puck.
Right.
And, you know, like, why isn't he shooting the puck? Why isn't he dishing
he's
the puck
off? He's at home. Here's my theory. He's at home, and he's doing all these extra fancy passes for all the millionaires that bought the seats in the lower levels.
Put the pucks in the net. That's how you're going to make the people happy.
He's making that behind the back, you know? Between the legs, passing. And, John, if you watch any hockey, you can join in any time. So, do you watch hockey at all?
Yeah, I've watched a few of the games.
Three games this year.
Every one they lose, okay. I watch.
Don't watch anymore then.
Okay.
Okay, we'll leave John alone on that. But, Chip, getting back to my theory. Thanks, John. But on my theory with why you see a difference in the fans there, it's so quiet there. I think a lot of these people bought these very expensive tickets with their companies and blocks of seats, and they like getting their little food, and they're showing up there, and they have the seats, but you don't see them banging on the glass, jumping around down there.
And that's, I think one of the things that the NHL did was they priced themselves out of the working class's market, okay? Because here's what happens. All these corporations buy up all these blocks of tickets, and you got tickets at $140, $150 bucks a pop, and you got three home games in a week. Who's going to be able to afford to do that? You know,
right.
The reason why the Pirates put 2 million people through the turnstiles last year is a baseball game is an affordable evening out. You know, you don't have to go and spend $400 bucks to go watch the Pirates play. But you know, you want to take a date down to the console. You're spending $1.50 for tickets each. You're spending $20 for parking, and then you go in there if you get a beer and a plate. Nachos, you know, you've spent.
Hold it! You already hit Smoking Jim's level of all you can eat in a seat for $35. Can't even do that. So that's the difference in the crowd.
But then, I mean, like at Steeler games, you see the blue collar worker. You see the guys that are, you know, the hourly workers at those games, and they're very passionate about it. You see all these people in suits and stuff sitting around, and you know they just, you know, it just. The rabid fan that you don't see there so much.
They got to go to the upper levels.
And like I said, I think they've priced themselves out of it being, you know, I mean, sure, we've sold out every game, but those tickets are all being sold, bought up by corporations, not by individual fans.
Right. Well, enough of what the fans are. I'm more concerned what they do on the ice. I like how they're splitting the goaltending with our man Fleury, and I forget the goaltender.
Volkoon.
Okay. Volkoon there. So that's just an inside joke, folks. We're just silly guys, but in other words, I like how they're performing there, and the defense has been playing pretty well. It's just we do have to shoot the puck more. I mean, that's one of my pet peeves, but don't you notice a difference when Letang's not in there? And that's what I see. They lose more games for whatever reason when Letang's not playing.
Yeah,
and I noticed that.
Yeah, and you know, they've got a couple of defensemen, you know, and it's amazing that Letang goes on the IR the day after they trade Ben Lovejoy, who would have been an adequate fill-in. But, you know, they had eight defensemen and six spots that they could keep. And you know, Lovejoy's going to have to play somewhere. He's going to play for somebody. And, you know, they gave him up for, you know.
Just a little peck there.
Yeah. But, I mean, you know, the defense is playing better. You know, I think right now that the offense is not nearly as good as it can be. And I think that's a product of just passing the puck too much. You know, hockey's real simple. You throw the puck at the net, you crash the net, you're going to score goals. That's not what we're seeing. We see people trying to make that, you know,
fancy.
That highlight pass. They want to make it onto SportsCenter. And, you know, they pass up a lot of opportunities that way.
Well, we covered three of my favorite sports, and we're going to go back now to one of my all-time favorites from when I was a kid. We brought John Galezo on.
One second before we do that, just wanted to give the fans out there, everybody knows I'm a professional gambler.
Yes.
Anybody that want to make some real easy money before March Madness, get with the Miami Hurricanes. Best basketball team I've seen in the last 10 years. 10-0 in the ACC right now. So get on the Miami Hurricane bandwagon and you'll have vacation money this summer.
To interrupt you, he does have some of these great winners. And he's loading this all up on Facebook. So he's been promoting that on Facebook and how this will be one of the greatest teams. And Smokin' Jim just doesn't do that to stir people up. Well, you know, he likes to make the green here.
But, you know, Pitt's moving to the ACC next year. And these are some of the teams that Pitt's going to be playing regularly, Duke,
right.
North Carolina, Miami. But here's the thing I find kind of interesting is that Indiana with three losses is ranked number one. Duke with two losses is ranked number two. And Miami is ranked below Duke, and they're both in the ACC, and Miami is undefeated in the ACC. How do you get ranked lower than Duke?
Hold it.
Wait a second.
One better thing. I'm not a huge basketball fan, but I do watch the sport. Miami, how many points have they beat? What, Duke?
North Carolina?
I think by 100 and some points, if you combine both games. So to me, it's like the BCS. When we talk about the BCS Bulls and the polls.
You know, maybe Brother Ray went down there and he touched the players on the chest.
No. Let that go. We're going to have to deal with that on ESPN.
Because his boy is going to be playing ball at the
right.
next
That's
year.
That's true.
And we're going to have to hear him on ESPN, so I'm not looking forward to it. I know Smokin' Jim can't wait. But now it's baseball time again. I've had my man in the bullpen here. John, what's on your mind with baseball now? We'll just talk straight up baseball here.
I tell you, the other thing that's on my mind with the Pirates is their farm system. They, depending upon where you look or what you read, different sites have them as either the number three ranked minor league organization out there, number seven.
In all of baseball.
And they got some guys down there. Now, obviously, you've got Jameson Taillon, the pitcher.
We didn't even mention him.
Gerrit Cole. You got Luis Heredia, the kid who's 18 years old out of Latin America.
Yep.
What about the Indian pitchers?
Well, you know what? One of those guys is still around.
I heard he's not bad. That's why I'm bringing it up.
One of those guys.
I know a little bit about baseball, too, Chipper.
I want to tell you something. You know, everybody sits there
some command of his pitches.
John and I both agree that we think that Clint Hurdle is a great manager, and he's a great manager in this situation right here in Pittsburgh. But I tell you what, everybody's going to badmouth, you know, Neil Huntington and Bob Nutting and everything. Back in 2007, when he brought in Huntington, you know, there wasn't a farm system, because it had been completely devastated. There wasn't a single prospect that any team would want. And now you look at what the Pirates have got in their system, and they, you know, I've checked on a couple of websites, and the Pirates, you know, I saw them ranked as high as seventh or eighth. John says number three. So they've got a top 10 minor league organization, which is how you build a major league team. You've got to have the talent in the minors that's going to make it to the pros. And we've got guys on our major league roster right now that have come up through our minor league system. And that is their biggest achievement so far. And that is going to equate to wins in on the major league level.
And on that point, I agree that they did change how the team was in the minor leagues. They had issues, and McClatchy was involved with it and all the other owners. Nutting bought them out and took major control then. So he's actually been in charge since 07, even though he's been part of this team for a while. And one reason that I notice, I sort of think outside the box, when you look at how Major League Baseball made some rules, what did they do? They made the pirate rule because of all the money they spent in the minor leagues. They changed how much you're allowed to spend in the minor leagues now. To me, we've seen it in the NFL, the Steelers of the 70s. Look at Mel Blount. I know I'm mixing sports, but when they notice something, that somebody's doing something different, that they're actually improving, they try to change that or stop it. And that's what happened.
Here's where I find the flaw in that, because because they can sit there and look at the way the Pirates are spending money on minor league ball players. You know, I think what would be better for the whole sport of Major League Baseball is if they limited what the major league teams can spend, level the playing field more often.
Because, we're not going there
the
money is all, it's too great there,
right,
Chip.
It is. And I get that. But in the environment that the Pirates live in right now, the market that they have, they are building this team the right way. They're moving in the right direction. We all wanted them to win yesterday. We wanted them to win last year. I wanted them to win in 2011.
I wanted them to win 15 years ago.
But you know what?
This is 20 years. It's the worst.
Alan,
worst sport.
I'm telling you what.
With a losing record 20 years in North America.
Alan, it's half empty.
No, it's Alan, full. There's a lot of air.
This is the time when you want to be a Pirate fan. Okay? This is when you want to be a Pirate fan.
All right. I'm going to finish my last bit of Pirate Kool-Aid.
The sport of baseball. You know, now is the time that you want to be a baseball fan, because you're going to see some of the best baseball around. And if you enjoy the sport, I just say sit back and enjoy
it. Chip,
the ride.
I enjoy it, but I don't like the end results of it.
Are you a hurdle hater?
Yes,
no,
he is.
Here's the problem.
It depends on who he's talking to.
Wait, no. I'm not a true.
I have my theory. Go ahead.
No, I don't hate hurdle, but I hate his gut. Because early in the year, he plays by gut feelings. And he says that. He admits that. Well, I do a lot of things in life by my gut, too. But sometimes I get indigestion. And I feel sometimes maybe he can't burp or whatever. You know, these are guys here. They do other things, and it's sophomoric humor. I think he swallows that wad of gum, and he leaves a guy in to give up 12 runs. Or he has a pitcher that's out of shape like McDonald at the end of the year, and he can't even throw a ball. I thought it was a tired arm. Here he was out of shape. Because it wasn't a tired arm. I know some people in the Pirate organization that this kid doesn't want to stay in shape. Just like we had a guy, I'm not even going to go, Tabata. You can run to catch a ball, but you can't run out of ball to first base. You can't have selective hamstring injuries. These are some of the things.
Tabata has ownership in Golden Corral. You didn't know that?
I didn't know, but that's okay. And when you don't produce like that, I don't care about the talent. I don't hate Hurdle, but I did disagree with when times were worse, he started to manage with the gut even more, and it made the problem worse. He cost us a few games where he won us a few earlier. Go ahead.
We talked about this before the show, and here's my take on this.
All right.
I love Clint Hurdle. Now, he's the best manager we've had in quite some time. Now, granted, that's not saying much.
It's not.
Compared to Russell, he's...
You're too smart a man to argue
absolutely
about that.
But I will tell you this, though. At some point, the Garrett Jones, the Neil Walkers, the Andrew McCutchins...
Absolutely.
...have to hold their own boys accountable and be the leaders on that team. Clint Hurdle cannot field ground balls, and he can't hit fast.
Here's part of the problem. You have all these players that are prima donnas. They're making the millions of dollars. They don't care about the guy next to them. They're worried about being on a cover of a game. They're worried about getting all these votes. They're worried about all the publicity, and then they're tweeting and doing all that stuff too. So you don't have that like when we played ball, like when all of us.
You know what?
You're talking about McCutchin being a self-serving
individual. No, I didn't mention him, but I'm saying that's the mentality. I like McCutchin. I'm glad we signed him for $51 million because I think he's worth more than that.
But Alan,
but the problem aren't going to be accountable.
But what John's point is that, you know, the players have to accept some accountability here. Yeah, everybody wants to point the finger at the manager and he's making bad decisions. But you know what? At some point, the players have to, and they have to be held accountable by one another. So if Clint Hurdle does anything in this spring training, he needs to, you know, kick a couple of guys in the rear end and make them be the leaders of that team.
I would agree with you if we get the fundamentals that I learned in Little League and you've learned playing sports, that we still have to learn that in the major leagues. So I blame some of the coaching that keep yelling at them. If they don't hear you, that's fine. And maybe a couple of these players who are the prima donnas, whoever they are, because they're all like that, they aren't sports heroes. They're not heroes of mine. They're only sports heroes.
But,
and that's the difference. They don't step up.
Alan,
that's my. I disagree with you guys.
Until I see it. At you know, at one point you didn't have enough depth on your major league roster and nothing in your farm system. You had to live with who you had because you didn't have anybody else to put in there and be able to perform at a major league level. Now the options are a little bit better.
But here's my point to this. If I have a guy who's a superstar and should be and has all the talent and potential, I bench him. I'm the manager. I'm not going to be popular. But you know what that kid would learn? I'm not going to play for the Pirates anymore because I'm not doing the job. Now, they do try that at times. Hurdle sat people down.
Hurdle sat McCutcheon down.
That's why I said I like that. I'm not a hater.
He probably did that by his gut, though.
He did because he admitted that. That's why I'm not a hater. When the gut's on, I'm with them. But when the gut's not on, I can't help if players don't perform. You don't leave them in to get blasted out of the park.
Well, you know
if
what,
they're
Alan,
not producing,
that's sometimes,
sit them down again. That's what I say. That's where I differ with you guys.
Well,
and it's an opinion.
These aren't facts.
Clint Hurdle, and we were talking about this as well. I think Clint Hurdle needs to – he's a great motivational, positive manager. Now, he has to figure out a way to get them past that last hurdle.
I took the pun.
He has to find a way to get them into late August, mid-September, and get them past and keep playing that top-quality ball. Is he somewhat accountable to? Yes, but I feel like the players...
I hate to interrupt the baseball discussion during the spring training start, but we're going to have to end the show. John, you're welcome back to the show anytime.